Good afternoon and welcome to our informational meeting. First item on the agenda is City Council staff reports by Deborah Owen, City Clerk, Chief of Council Operations.
Thank you and good afternoon, Sioux Falls City Council. Just to give you an update where we are with the election proceedings as we head toward the April 13th election day, we have absentee voting starting tomorrow at the County Administration Building. We have just printed ballots. They're just hot off the press, and so they're waiting for those who want to absentee vote. Starting tomorrow, it'll be Monday through Friday at the County Administration Building between 8 and 5. Then also on April 10th, which is the Saturday prior to the April 13th election day, there is voting between 8 and noon on that Saturday as we keep that absentee voting and making that available for the convenience of the voters on the Saturday. And then finally, to remind everybody, we have the first of the forums with the City of Sioux Falls and the League of Women Voters and the Sioux Falls Chamber of Commerce. And that will be this Saturday, 9 o'clock to 10:30 will be the mayoral forums. It will be moderated by the League of Women Voters. And there'll be coffee served, I believe, provided by the Sioux Falls Chamber of Commerce. And as they are a partner on this event, that will be broadcast on Channel 16, rebroadcast on Channel 16. And you can also watch it at the SiouxFalls.org website. It'll be web streamed and then archived as well for future viewing. Thank you.
Okay. Next item is Mayor Munson's office. And at this time, I'd like Mark Cotter to come up. I've asked Mark to come talk to us today about the lift station on Tuttle Park, and we had a discharge into the river over the weekend, and he's going to update us on that and tell us what's going on.
Thank you, City Council. Mark Cotter with the Office of Public Works. I also have with me today Trent Lubers, which is Trent is responsible for running the wastewater plant and all the infrastructure, as well as Bob Kappel with the Environmental Division. Both were intricately involved in managing the situation and continue to be. Really, two events occurred. Our first one occurred where when the ice did break loose and started coming down the river, one of the key power poles that provides the three-phase power to this lift station, it's got guy wires on it that support the pole. One of the pieces of ice actually upset one of those guy wires and shorted out the power, so this lift station lost line power. They're all designed, these lift stations of this size are designed to go to automatic switch over to generated power so we can continue to provide service. Our team with Water Rec worked with XL Energy through the night to restore power to the lift station. And then really the next day we started to have additional issues just with the amount of flow coming into the system. We call it INI, it's inflow and infiltration, which means that it can, in addition to the regular sewage that's in the pipe that's collected from this large basin, inflow can be from an open source like the top of a manhole. Maybe a large piece of ice would dislodge a manhole casting and allow river water to go right into the system. Or just in this situation, this pipe is about 50 years old. As you know, we're on a pretty aggressive schedule to replace the central main. It's the backbone sewer of the city of Sioux Falls. And so if it doesn't come in flow into like a manhole or a breach in the pipe, it can come right in the joints. When the water table coming down the river is as high as it's been the last few days, that hydraulic pressure can go right through the groundwater and press into any joint or area where extra flow can go in. So that's really the three sources. The lift station was about three times the normal flow of what we normally see come to this lift station. And so it just gets to the point where you really have to start monitoring the lift station. And if there becomes a situation where we want to make sure that we don't have backed up sewers, and we certainly want to protect this lift station, because if we were to lose the lift station, it'd be a much bigger environmental issue. And so then we do call the state. Bob Kappel calls the state of South Dakota, the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, letting them know that we've kind of reached the last resort. And we did do intermittent discharges of wastewater into the Big Sioux River from about 3:30 yesterday afternoon to about 4 in the morning last night. Right away, we also, they go into another procedure where we start to monitor the health of the river upstream and downstream, and we start to grab samples every 6 hours and analyze them. And so far, the data that we've seen has all been very positive, that it's not, that there hasn't been an impact on the sanitary, on the river. So with that, there's obviously a lot of events, a lot of staff that work for both these two individuals that are looking for sources, that we're walking the entire central main, looking in every manhole. They're all bolted down, so it takes a while to actually get into those structures to really start to identify what the additional inflow could have been. If it is simply inflow through the joints, I can at least share with you our I can share with you the map of what's been underway. I'll start up here on the north end by the spillway. This green is all of the central main that's been replaced. You've supported the SRF notes that have taken that from a 48-inch pipe up to a 60-inch pipe. In 2010, late last year in November, we bid the next three projects of the central main, which they're in purple. And that's it's in the range of about $10 million worth of construction that's planned for this year. And then the orange is projects that we is the remaining portion of the central main that will also upsize from a 48-inch pipe to a 60-inch pipe. And again, that pipe's been in the ground for nearly 50 years, and so it's certainly time, and flow characteristics will be much better when the project's done. Those the projects that are in orange are in the five-year plan, and those are those will be a great improvement to the system, especially if it truly is infiltration through the joints. We'll have a very good pipe, a water main grade pipe that goes in to carry that wastewater. So with that, is there some questions that we can answer?
Mark, I'm just curious. So in the first event with the backup generator, so I assume the generator worked as it was supposed to and engaged?
It did engage, yep.
Okay. And then, I mean, I've been around for a little while, and I certainly recall having flooding at the level that we've had over the weekend. So I'm wondering about, you know, the source. To me, it doesn't seem that it, you know, from my uneducated view, that it would be coming in through the cracks or whatever. It almost, to me, it seems like it would have to be a breach, because haven't we endured, I mean, this type of minor flooding in the past without incident?
Well, one of the comparisons that we just recently looked back to is the rain events of 2004 and some of those instances. And we did have a breach in the system there. That's where we actually had an inflow source into a manhole. But this is the highest that of historic flows that we've seen come into this lift station that our staff is aware of. So it is a little perplexing. That's why Trent has his crews out actively looking for anything that could either be an obstruction in the line or just multiple inflow sources. So we're hoping to know more in the coming days.
So then, so the inflows into the system have not decreased?
They have decreased, and maybe I can actually have Trent come up and just share what he's seeing at the current lift station right now. Trent?
Trent Lubbers, Water Reclamation Superintendent. We were running earlier today. We were running between 14 and 15,000 gallons a minute at the lift station with two pumps, and we are dialed down. We're actually lowering the level of the wet well, and we're down to about 9,000 gallons a minute. The Sioux River South, which feeds Tut Hill Lift Station, is a large interceptor sewer. There's a lot of storage there. Obviously, the lift station's at a low point in the line, so you start backing up a certain amount of water in that and their storage. And so we're working through that volume of water that's stored in that large pipe, and we're getting through that now. So the fact that we're making a dent or a difference in the wet well tells us that we're seeing less inflow into the system. Wet well has typically, or the infiltration has typically been tracked with the level of Skunk Creek. When Skunk Creek reaches a level near flood stage or right at flood stage, when the soils are saturated, we see larger amounts of inflow than would be normal. We saw it in 2006. We had a rain event. After several rain events, there was saturated soil. 2004 was a little bit different. simply because the soil conditions weren't exactly the same except for the second event. And also, when you bring that water down through the Skunk Creek Basin, it goes down through the south side of town. So it hits the Sioux River North Interceptor, which is the northwest part of town. It hits Sioux River South, which is the south interceptor, which feeds Tud Hill. That Sioux River North Interceptor, when that gets saturated, pulls up that Skunk Creek Basin. That dumps into the central main through a lift station at the zoo. We found a major source of infiltration last night feeding that lift station. A piece of ice sheared off the metal casting on top of the concrete. So we had a 24-inch hole with 5 feet of water sitting on top of it, and it was acting as a big drain. We were draining the flooded areas of Skunk Creek. We had a team out there at midnight last night. They fabricated a steel plate, and they took it and put it out over the manhole in the rushing water, and it sucked it right down, and that stopped most of the infiltration of that. Once we got that buttoned up, we saw our levels start to come down. We have not overflowed since 4 a.m. when we shut things down. We have a man at the station 24/7, and we probably will at least till midnight tonight, monitoring the situation. We're getting off our daily peak, so I think we're going to get caught up. Talked to the hydrologist at the National Weather Service, and he said over the next 13 hours, we're going to see right at or right below flood stage, we're going to see a few fluctuations, but the last few ice jams have moved their way down off of Willow Creek and from Chester, and they're going to move through. So things are looking a lot more positive for us. I'd like to promise you that we're not going to have another overflow, but we haven't told the state that we're completely done yet, because I want to reserve the right if we get in that situation where we're surcharging back up and we have the potential to impact homes or worse yet, have several places where we have a release, and that's much harder for us to track and keep track of. So,
okay. So the inflow was actually coming from the zoo lift station?
I can't answer that completely yet. There was a significant inflow source that went to that zoo lift station, and that happened. We saw that when that was starting to break loose, would be my guess, throughout Sunday. And around 3 to 4 o'clock Sunday afternoon, the rest of the top came off because we saw a significant increase. We went from one pump to three pumps in like 10 minutes. The wet wells filled up. We couldn't keep up, and it broke loose. So that one, we know when that one happened. Around 4 o'clock on Saturday afternoon is when our flows really started to pick up at Tud Hill. And if you combine that with the hydraulic data from the National Weather Service, it's about the time the ice jam started to affect and impact the lower level of Sioux River South. My hope is that we can find that great big source of infiltration or inflow, because that's a lot easier and it makes me feel better because I know we have it fixed. It's quite possible that it is lots of, you're talking about 48-inch, you're talking about a 40-inch diameter. Every 10 to 12 feet, there's a crack in the pipe, and if that's starting to fail on 50-year-old pipe, when there's a lot of pressure coming in from hydraulic pressure, you know what a basement does when your soil's saturated, what your sump pump does, the water comes in, and it runs into those sump pits. So it could be that, and I'll take that times 10,000 foot of sanitary sewer. So I guess I feel better that we have a capital program in place that's going to replace that pipe and make it tighter. What was interesting about this event is Central Main was full also downstream of Tut Hill. So not only were we, before at Tut Hill, we were able to pump with three pumps at 15,000 gallons a minute. We were pumping with one pump at 100% and one between 75 and 85%. And we were pushing against water that was already in the Central Main. Checking Central Main today, I don't really have a real good source for you, but downstream of where Sioux Steel is, we're running between a half and two-thirds of a pipe. Upstream of that, for most of the day, we were running surcharge, and now we're starting to see the top of the pipe. So we're narrowing it down, and we're getting in there. My principal engineer is working on it from engineering, Mark Perry, and also the collection supervisor. Right now, they may have some concerns about the elbows, the 90-degree bends in the pipe as it moves through the parks. So that could be providing enough friction with the age on the pipe and that type of thing to slow things down with the additional infiltration.
So when will you have more information for us?
We're going to continue to walk the pipe and see if we can see anything from the surface. I want flows to be significantly less than they are now before we go in there with the camera. What we may end up doing is we essentially have a little float or a little boat that you, if you want to call it that, that we put the camera on, and we tie it on either side. And we actually just float a camera down the pipe. And so if we can't find anything, if we can't find any big smoking guns in the next couple of days as we walk those sections and pop all those manholes, when flows get down to a more typical level, we'll get in there with the camera and we'll take a look. There's not a significant or total obstruction, because if there was, we would have a sewage coming out of a manhole somewhere between where that obstruction was and Central Main, and that's not the case.
Okay. Any questions for Trent? Thank you very much. Now, Mark, did you have an update for us on your road projects or road?
Yes, just wanted to encourage you to come out tomorrow and Wednesday. Tomorrow is on-site on Western Avenue. Street Department will be out there. We've invited the media to come out and just see all the steps to properly fix a pothole. And we're also hoping we don't have to reschedule all the events like we did last week after all the rain came. And then Wednesday should really be significant, just to see some of the key pieces that are being prefabricated to accelerate all the steps of the 41st Street Bridge. Gage Brothers has already been well underway with casting all those large beams. We'll start in their office seeing some of the boards and talking about some of the sequence, and then we'll actually be able to just peer out into their fabrication yard and see these massive structures that soon will be traveling toward the 41st Street Bridge. So tomorrow's event is 10:30 on West Avenue. It'll be southbound lanes at Madison Street. You can park on a service road, and then on Wednesday, same time, 10:30 at Gage Brothers on West 12th Street. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Mark and Trent and Bob, for coming down and shedding some light on that for us. Okay, next item on the agenda is the Audit Committee.
No report.
Fiscal Committee?
No report.
Land Use Committee?
No report.
Public Services Committee?
We do have a report. We last week had the final hearing before the Vehicles for Hire issue comes back to the council tonight. I've asked Deborah Gajkowski to come up and talk specifically about there are two options that the council can consider tonight. One is a price cap, and I'm going to have Deborah go through those for you, and the other would be to take the price caps off completely. So with that, Deborah, if you could walk through the pricing. This came from when we started this process, both companies that do wheelchair transport offered what they thought would be reasonable price caps, and the committee accepted Wheelchair Express's caps. And with that, I will have Deborah walk us through those.
Good afternoon. Deborah Gajkowski, transit planner with the city. As Vernon said, we have two options that we can take with these wheelchair transport rates. The deregulation, or I guess I don't want to call it deregulation, the caps on the fares, that was presented to you a few weeks ago, and since then we've heard from several of the people that use the services, and they've expressed some concern about that. So what we did is we came up with some proposed rates of our own. We had quite a bit of discussion about that last week in the Public Services Committee, and basically by the time we were finished, we decided to go with the Wheelchair Express rates. They also decided to go with a fuel surcharge. Right now, the taxi cab companies have a fuel surcharge, and it's basically they can increase the amount that they charge for their services for each trip by 10 cents for every 15 cents that the price of gas goes up. So where the price of gas is right now, they can charge about $1.20 more per trip for their services. The rates that Wheelchair Express came up with, I get the impression that it's more long-term. The last time they came before us for a rate increase was 10 years ago. The rates that I had proposed and I came up with was more short-term, like 1 to 2 years. But with that, you know, if you go with their rates, they always have the option to charge the maximum they want as soon as they want. But they say that they just want that flexibility right now to not have to come back to the City Council to make those changes. Any questions about that?
Deborah, on the rates that you're recommending, are they indexed so that, you know, a year from now or 2 years after we have more inflation, or if
no.
there is inflation that?
No, they are not.
Is there not a reasonable index that we can tie that to? There's got to be a CPI transportation or some sort of index that would be meaningful to tie the rates to.
That would be an option. I have not heard of any other services doing that as far as transportation services.
Councilor Knutson.
Thank you, Deborah, for being with us today. I, as you all know, I am on the Public Services Committee and unfortunately have missed the last two meetings, and I apologize for that. But I want you to know I'm still very engaged on this topic and every other topic. And a couple thoughts that I have is I'm fairly caught up from your last meeting last week. And personally, I would be more comfortable splitting the difference between a company's suggested rates and our staff's. And actually, I was thinking very much like you, Councilor Costello, on wondering, you know, I realize the companies have not had a rate increase for 10 years, but I mean, I know numbers are rather subjective and so forth, even though, I mean, there can be. But I was wondering also if there was some CIP consumer index plan that we could use to, I guess, strengthen our suggested numbers. And then secondly, I am frankly adamantly opposed to the fuel surcharge. I think that that has to be a bookkeeping nightmare. I believe that it is not working very well for our current ordinance as far as the taxi services are concerned, because again, you're supposed to be, if I'm in the taxi business, I'm supposed to be submitting all these receipts of where I buy gas and when I buy gas, and I never ever hear anyone say when the price of gas goes down, we're going to lower our rates. So I would, again, apologize for not being at the committee meeting, so I'm speaking up now to give you my personal thoughts on the proposal right at this moment.
Just on the proposed rates, this is something that, you know, at the last meeting, we definitely wanted to hear from the consumers and wanted to make sure that they were comfortable with what we were going to propose. And I think at the end of the meeting, after a lot of input, that this was something that they were going to be comfortable with. And as far as the fuel surcharge, you know, we do have it on the taxis right now, and until we can come up with something better, you know, as far as tracking this and everything, and maybe working with Deborah, we can do that. I would like to see that stay on right now until we come up with something that's more, you know, satisfying as far as tracking purposes. But as far as the rate increase in that we've agreed on, I think that is something that's more middle ground between as far as what we were looking at proposing and what the wheelchair companies were. So I think we came up with some pretty good numbers there after a few good meetings, and I want to thank Deborah and the city attorney's office also for making a meeting with Vernon and I to keep discussing rates and, you know, keep this alive. But I think what we've got now is a good start and something that both the user groups and the businesses can be comfortable with until we come up with something better, if it's a CPI or whatever.
Thank you, Councilor Anderson. And again, like I said, I apologize for not being there last Monday, and know that you were working very hard as a committee on, or have been working very hard on this topic, and I really appreciate all the efforts some of you have put into this topic. A question is, did you guys ever consider tying any kind of a plan into the fact, at least, that there has to be at least two companies in the wheelchair express business, you know, so at the point that if someone buys the other one, and I'm not starting any rumors, I haven't heard that anyone's going to do that, I mean, as far as a monopoly in this business. But again, it is a difficult topic. I mean, I think it's a difficult topic on what the right thing to do is, and I'm struggling some with what is the right thing. But I was wondering, as far as just keeping at least whatever ordinance we're going to go with in the end, do we want to tie it to the fact at least when there's competition? Because I think these citizens who use these services are incredibly vulnerable people. I just, you know, the rest of us can walk, we can ride bicycles, we can drive our cars and take taxis really easily.
I can address that. No, we did not discuss that, but I think that we always have the option as a council to go back and revisit the ordinance should the market change. There are times when there are more than two wheelchair transport services, but the current environment there are only two.
Well, I also like the CPI better than the fuel surcharge, because the fuel surcharge is going to go up and down all the time. There's going to have to be some averages figured. But the question I would have with the CPI is, what are we going to use for a base year? There's some conversations about when they started to need this increase and where it is now and where it's going to go. But we're still going to have some sort of base to base those changes on in the future.
Yeah, I don't necessarily have the answer on that. It just seems inconceivable to me how we would want to just create the same mess we got today for 5 years down the road or 8 years down the road. That it, you know, there's got to be some inflationary factor in there, because you know, otherwise we're going to be right back where we are today. Councilor Knudsen?
Yeah, Councilor Bennett, I really agree with that concern, too. I was wondering if the fairest year might be to, you know, go 10 years ago when the rate was set, but I'm not, this is not an area of expertise for me, so I, you know, from an economic standpoint or accounting standpoint, I don't know.
Councilor Jamieson? Well, I'm sorry, were you done?
Not quite. The other thing I wanted to say is, Councilor Brown, I do apologize for 3 meetings ago when I was very much there and we discussed this. I had just not thought about that, you know, one company, two company bit. So I apologize for not throwing that out sooner. I hadn't thought about it, frankly, to be real honest with you. And then a question I have for our staff person, who's much more of an expert than I am ever will be on transit issues, is I'm curious right now from a practical standpoint. I know we, including I, put that fuel surcharge on the taxi, you know, deregulation bit. I voted for that, no doubt about that. I'm just curious from a practical standpoint, how is that really working?
Right now with the taxi companies, I think we all know that the price of fuel has gone up considerably over the last several months. I have not received anything from any taxi company for probably 8 to 9 months. And whenever the price of gas does go down, I never get any information. There's a couple of companies that every once in a while will send something in, but really it's only two companies out of 10 or 11 taxi companies.
Yeah.
Councilor Brown.
Maybe just for the sake of discussion, you have the increase, proposed increases from wheelchair transport in your red notes. I thought Deborah did a really fine job of going through and analyzing her recommendations. Do you want to give the council what your recommendations were for rates, so they just for comparison's sake? And
sure. What I did was the rates that Wheelchair Express and Sioux Falls Wheelchair gave to me is they took the time period from January 1st through June 30th. So I looked at that same time frame for our paratransit services and what our expenses were per trip for those paratransit services. So I kind of used that as a base, and then I went from there and considered several factors and differences between the two services. For instance, the wheelchair providers are 24/7, 365 days a year, where paratransit is not. So I figured they'd probably have to pay a higher wage for labor in the middle of the night. Paratransit service is a curb-to-curb service unless door-to-door is required. The wheelchair companies are basically door-through-door, so it requires a little more time every time they go to pick somebody up. So I took that into consideration. The reservation period, the wheelchair companies, they'll go out. You call, they'll go out immediately, where paratransit service, you need a reservation by 5 o'clock the day ahead of time. So I figured, you know, maybe the man hours are more or the number of vehicles they need is more because of that. So I took that into consideration. The vehicles that we have capacity for a maximum of 7 wheelchairs. I think that their vehicles are a little bit smaller, so they may need more vehicles to do the services. So I also took that into consideration. Some of the things that paratransit service has to abide by, because we do get some federal funding for our vehicles, is the drug and alcohol testing. We have to do that, which, you know, it's a little bit of an expense, and they are not required to do that. We also have a preventive maintenance schedule that we have to follow, that FTA comes and makes sure that we follow that every 3 years they come. So I took all of those things into consideration when I came up with the rates, and I also considered the fuel and the cost of fuel going up a little bit. And so my rates were a little bit less than theirs, and they basically said they were completely unacceptable, that they couldn't run a business at the rates that I proposed. But one thing I would really like to point out that came out in the meeting several times is that if we were to increase these rates, you know, whether we do it at my rates or their rates, it only affects 20% of their ridership. All their other services are either contract services or paid for through Medicaid. So one of their biggest arguments is that they need this increase to make a profit, and they need new vehicles. So that's why they want this fare increase. But basically, it's coming off of 20% of their riders is where their increase is coming.
So the Medicaid sets the rate for that they'll pay. The contract services, I wonder, are you, by any chance, you know how much that makes up? Because I would imagine if I was going to contract with them, I'd start with what the cap was and then work my way down. So
I do know that the Medicaid services, like for a one-way, is like $17.50. And their proposed rate is $35 for a one-way.
Councilor Jameson.
I went to the Public Services Committee meeting last week. Actually walked into the meeting thinking, this is a no-brainer. Deregulate the thing. The city needs to get out of the way. There's just no question about it. You know, with all the things I differ with Kermit on, this would be one of those that I would agree on. But sitting through the committee meeting, I got to hear some of the stories of the people who use that service, and I could pick up a sense of vulnerableness. And so I guess my challenge tonight is to probably bridge that gap between getting out of the way for public or for private businesses and protecting the citizens in some way. I guess that's my struggle tonight, but I just can't imagine spending this much time talking about two private businesses. We should be focusing on paratransit and helping it do a better job. That's our system. And let these guys do their own business as they see fit. And as long as there is competition, that really is the beginning of whether this works or not. If there was only one other business providing it, maybe we need to step in. But with two of them competing for the same customers, I think that's the checks and balance that needs to occur naturally. And who knows, maybe one of us will get in the paratransit or the wheelchair service business if these guys jack their rates up too high and they can't sustain it. But that's my struggle tonight, is to find a way that we can get out of the business of regulating these guys and but still protect them. And I'm not sure how to do that yet. And hopefully tonight we'll come up with that solution.
Councilor Bennigan.
Deborah, do you know how many paratransit applications are turned down?
I do not. And one of the main things we're looking for when we call it a mobility needs assessment, we're basically looking to see if the person can access the fixed route system. We're not looking to see, you know, how disabled they are and that kind of thing. And it's more, can they access a fixed route system by where they live or whatever? So if they can, they use fixed route.
It's more of a medical clearance, isn't it, in some cases?
In some cases, yes.
And then the other piece of that is we probably then don't know how many applications that we would get for the hours that we're not in service, that they are in service for weekends or whatever. Mm-hmm. We don't know how many applications those are either, I'm sure.
Right. No.
Councilor Knutson.
Deborah, would you remind us, please, about 10 years ago, how many businesses existed in Sioux Falls providing these services? First question. And then secondly, would you please remind us and the listening audience of what the two names of the companies are and how long they've been in business, if you have that with you?
As far as I know, there were two businesses in running a business when the last rate was proposed 10 years ago. It's Sioux Falls Wheelchair and Wheelchair Express. I'm not sure if other businesses have been in business since then or not. Some, the wheelchair company business owners say there were. We don't really have record of it in licensing. So,
thank you.
Well, during this time, we had one of the clerks look up, and there is, in fact, a consumer price index category for transportation services and medical care services. appears to be the one that best fits the description. So I will, my first inclination is this evening is to not have caps. I mean, I understand the vulnerability of the clientele, but I can't help but think that the free market system and competition was the best way to foster that. And if we didn't have caps, that maybe one of our existing taxi companies might be willing to make the investment into a vehicle to offer that service, or maybe more of them will. So that's where I'm kind of headed. But in the event that does not work, I will definitely be proposing an amendment to tie that whatever rates that we are to implement tonight at a cap would be indexed on this particular CPI index. So, Councilor Brown.
And maybe what we could do, Gail, in Section 4311, item number 2 is where the surcharge is. Could we have an amendment prepared with that CPI index with transportation and medical CPI?
By tonight, you mean?
Right.
Well, I'm not sure. We'd have to talk to Karen Leonard, who's really the ordinance drafter in our office. So I could contact her afterwards, or maybe Deborah could. Maybe Deborah could contact her right after this discussion is over with and see if she's able to do that. If not tonight, I'm sure she could draft something in accordance with what the council does.
Seems like it's a pretty straightforward intent, so I wouldn't think it'd be too difficult to
draft
that.
I think the only thing we'd want to do is then eliminate the fuel surcharge portion of it.
Just replace section or number 2 under section 4311 with the CPI instead of the fuel surcharge.
So just so I understand this correctly, you would have like a base rate, and then you have a percentage that it increases every year?
Well, my idea would be, and I'm certainly open for discussion here, is that my idea would be to be if we in fact are going to have a cap, that is the base rate, and this year, 2010, would be the starting year. And then so in 2011, we would adjust the cap by the inflationary rate of the CPI Transportation Medical Services Index. Does that make sense to people?
Using the Wheelchair Express rates to start with.
Whatever rates whatever rates the council decides tonight, okay. Whatever the rates they are, that we would index those for the future years.
And Councilor Costello, are you at this time, do you prefer the rates the staff has proposed on this or the rates that Wheelchair Express has proposed?
I'm just saying whatever rates we determine tonight, that they be indexed.
Okay, thank you.
I don't know that I have a strong feeling either way. Councilor Brown.
And I would just remind the council, as Deborah indicated earlier, those are our price caps. They've said that that's not where they're going to begin charging. So it does provide some room within that. So just keep that in mind as well.
One other question, and I should know the answer to this, so I apologize for asking because I should know the answer to this. I've sensed all along since this discussion has been going on for quite a while that it's pretty much been one of the two businesses that has been really lobbying on this issue and not the other one. I mean, that's not right or wrong. I'm just saying, is that the case or am I confused?
Councilor Brown?
Last meeting, only one was represented, yes.
And I was thinking that there all of the other meetings, too, that there have been mostly the push by one.
You're correct.
So I was kind of curious, I guess is where I'm going with this question. I was kind of curious, how does the other company that is in this business 24 hours a day, how do they feel about this issue? And I just haven't heard from them myself as a city councilor.
They did provide what they thought would be reasonable price caps as well. They provided that to Deborah. And she said, maybe if you could email that table that you had for the committee so they could see what both companies proposed and what your rates proposed were, it might give them a good overview of that.
You can do that.
Thank you.
Councilor Anderson.
Over on that chart, you'll see that Sioux Falls Wheelchair's rates were a little higher than Wheelchair Express's. So the ones that I took a look at were the Wheelchair Express rates and the rates that Councilor Brown, Deborah, and I had proposed too. And decided just to bump them up to the Wheelchair Express rates. So they were sort of in the middle of what we were thinking and what the highest rates were proposed.
Councilor Knutson.
And I actually do have I do have that chart, and I'm actually going to hand it to you, Councilor Costello, just for this evening.
Okay. Any other questions for Deborah?
Councilor One Ryan? More, if I could. Do you have the average cost of a paratransit run?
Well, the average cost when I did this information was like $23.82, which fluctuates every month depending on the number of passengers and miles driven and all that.
And Deborah, can you also tell us how many rides does paratransit do a day?
A little over 600 a day.
Using how many buses?
We have 22 paratransit buses.
Any other questions for Deborah? Thank you very much, Deborah.
Thank you.
Next item on the, or I'm sorry, public services, was that it? Or public
That's
service?
It. Okay. Yes.
Next item on the agenda is City Council open discussion. I'll start it off with, there's been some talk over the last 6-8 months or whatever about new monitors for the council, and Deborah has some information, so we'll see what you have.
Thank you. And we have one of the monitors that is at Councilmember Litz has that monitor. As you can see, it's very large, but also the stand that it came with, which was next to the old one, the old monitor over on the inside, it's much too large, and it would be blocking the view of council members to the audience and vice versa. And so we're asking if we can send those back. I know we had talked about ordering them late last fall. Apparently, a good measure of those were delivered to the city in December, but they were holding them until the last three, which were back-ordered and came in last week. So there's some concerns whether they can send them back or not, given how much time the city has held on to them. But they are very large, as you can tell, and there's no stand for them. If we took the stand off and lowered them to that level where it is now with Councilmember Litz, it's actually okay in terms of height, but it's unstable, and so there's just been a request to find out if we can return them and receive a refund. So that's where it is right now. Your thoughts, please.
And one of the other options that we were kicking around, Greg and I and Deborah, early in the week, is that maybe not have monitors and maybe have a couple of large screens mounted up on the wall so that we could see those and eliminate the monitors altogether. There's probably pros and cons to that, but Councilor Brown?
I'm perfectly fine with the monitors we have.
Councilor Knutson?
Yeah, I couldn't agree with Councilor Brown more on that. I mean, I've used these monitors for just short of 8 years, and they just work fine, and in the spirit of fiscal responsibility, I do not feel, I know I'm going to be gone in 2 months, but these just work slick for me.
If I could, just some of the monitors actually need to be replaced. I think they've already replaced Councilmember Anderson's earlier. Certainly some on this side. I think over there the monitors are better, but maybe just replacing them would be the appropriate thing to do at this point in time. At this point, we're just waiting to see if we can return the ones that were ordered by IT to see if we can get our money back.
Any other monitor comments? If not, maybe we can let Deborah know the thoughts in an email or something. Any other city council, councilor?
Yeah, just open discussion.
Open discussion, yeah.
Just a reminder, and I'm really sharing this more for people in the audience than I am for all of you, because you've seen the email recently, that this Wednesday morning is our regular breakfast club. And again, we all know that the county is organizing those meetings this year. But again, that will take place on St. Patrick's Day morning at 7:30 a.m. and Leonardo's restaurant at the Washington Pavilion. And I just wanted to share that since we have lots of candidates in the audience, and I think it's really good to continue to help them learn the system to be able to replace some of us just seamlessly. And the topics, just for your information, are one, a wrap-up of the legislative session, two, a briefing on the mobile crisis teams, and again, there's a helpful article in the front page of the local newspaper today on some House legislation on mobile crisis teams. And then three, the third topic on the agenda, I believe, is just a roundtable discussion. Commercial here for city business is the State of the City speech is coming up soon, and that is March 24th.
4th, I believe is the right date, at 1:30 p.m. And usually that speech is given here, but it will be given at the Orpheum Theater this year. So you might want to make a note of that for those of you who plan to attend. A lesser topic, I think, and this is no big deal to me, on number 15 for tonight, the information that's the very interesting information that's provided in the red notes, I think all that bank stabilization bit, I don't think that really applies very much to the ordinance for tonight. I think that information is helpful and pertains more to what was discussed last week. So that's just a very small comment and not important to me. And then on a much more important topic is most of you know that working with refugees is just a real, real high priority in my life. And is what I'd like to do is the I participated recently in a focus group with the Multicultural Center. And again, I continue to just think that as we bring in 300-350 refugees a year, not the city of Sioux Falls, but Lutheran Social Services, that it's really important for our community to continue to improve the programs for our for those great people who are coming here, some with almost nothing. And anyway, in the spirit of just making more suggestions for improving the services we provide to refugees, I would like to request, first of all, by the Audit Committee, an audit of the Multicultural Center from this last year or a couple years or how many ever years you want to go back on that. Again, I believe that the city of Sioux Falls, meaning us, the city councilors, approved about $90,000 for out of our general fund last year, for this budget, 2010, and about $35,000 for driver's education. And again, I'm sure that's, well, anyway, I'll just say that I would like to request an audit of the Multicultural Center, and I've been thinking about this for a long time, and I'm running out of time to do that. And then, secondly, because I was one of the government people involved in a focus group a few weeks ago, and people really did share quite a few concerns, I would say serious concerns, in the focus group I attended. The focus group was conducted by the University of South Dakota Government Research Bureau. And I would like to request at an informational in the near future, the sooner the better, frankly, that we have a presentation on the results of those focus groups at an informational meeting. And one reason that I'm requesting that is I believe that the funding for those focus groups was contingent on the fact that that the results would be provided to the city and county government entities, maybe school board too, I'm not sure, but the Sioux Falls Area Foundation provided those funds. And I think it would be good, again, in the spirit of following what the funds were provided for, that we have a presentation. So, again, I would really like to see that presentation lined up as soon as we have time on our agenda. And I forgot my notes, but I believe the guy that the head of the USD Government Research Bureau that did the focus groups is named Bill Anderson. And so those are my two requests.
Okay. If would you be able to forward us the email, the information on
sure.
Who that is, maybe forward
I'll
that to
that
Deborah?
I'll do that before our 7 o'clock meeting. I'll be happy to. And yes.
And we have Rich Oaksell is here today. And I think we already have the Multicultural Center set up for an audit, but Rich can maybe speak to that a little bit.
Rich Oaksell, lead internal auditor. We have that on our 2010 plan. We had some requests from the council to put that on our 2010 plan. We will probably start that probably this spring, that particular audit, and I probably want to meet with several individual council members just to make sure that our audit objectives are what you want us to specifically look at. So we do that have that on the plan. So
thank you.
Councilor Anderson.
In response to the focus group's findings and everything, that has been presented to the Board of Directors. We are finishing processing that. When we are done with that, I'm sure that the Board will be happy to come and make a presentation.
Okay. And could you give me a timetable on that? Again, I'm just thinking about some of us who are going off, and new people going on, and sometimes I was just wondering what timetable are you looking at, Councilor Anderson?
We just received it here at the end of last week, so we haven't even had a chance to really go over everything yet, so I can't give you a timetable at this time, Dee.
I would still like, I mean, I
we will work on it as soon as we can, but like I said, there's other issues that are also going on. The processing of this, the completing of the all the findings and everything. So until the board meets again, which is at the end of this month, I think it's a couple weeks, then we'll be able to give you a better idea of when we'll be able to present that information.
Okay,
but that money, that focus group was not paid for or funded by the city. That was funded by the Sioux Falls Community Foundation. So that is basically something that we need to finish going through and completing before we release that information.
Right, and not in an argumentative fashion at all with Councilor Anderson. I appreciate his comments on that and realize that he is on that board, and I thank him for his service on that board. Again, there are actually really quite a few concerns out in the community, and I'm fine with not scheduling that immediately, but I would hope that it could be done by late April.
I would think we could do it before that. Yes.
That would be just great. Again, there are some significant issues out there, including at least three recent board resignations, including the president of the board. And I mean, it's really kind of time that we get kind of caught up to speed on the multicultural center.
Why don't you continue to send that email, and okay, we'll look to get something scheduled and work with Councilor Anderson on that as well. Any other, Councilor Jameson?
Yeah, I've got something I need to get off my chest. About a year ago, I went to the AC/DC concert in Fargo. You guys remember that? I do a little show and tell. But I want to do another one. No, I won't. But Tuesday I went to Bon Jovi in Omaha at the Quest Center. You know, walking into that place, it's just a jewel of a place. If you've ever been there, it's just a great place. And I was jealous, you know, walking in, but also proud of what they've done. Anyway, I just wanted to share that I went to another concert out of town. But also, it's got me kind of thinking about this whole event center process. And some of the things I try to do in working on the council is think about what's going to happen after what happens next. And one of those things that's going to happen next is that they're going to build in a casino in Larchwood with a small convention center, and that's going to happen. Now, we're going to sit here and watch it happen, or possibly we can do something. I don't know if that's a funding source for the event center or not, but it seems like it's a piece of the puzzle that maybe could get put together with other sources, make a deal with the governor. It didn't work with the legislature, but fine. Let's try to make a deal with the governor. If the governor doesn't want to play, let's find another way. But we can't sit here and watch that casino be built, because in just a few years, I can already see the some group who would normally come to Sioux Falls for an event heads over to Larchwood to play a couple rounds of golf and have their committee meetings over in the convention center and have a great time in Larchwood. It's almost like we're just getting picked at from sides, all of our sides. This one now comes from Larchwood. We're already losing money to Sioux City. They love it, the work that we can't figure ourselves out. Fargo's happy because we're still stumbling around. Rapid City probably thinks we don't know what we're doing. We've got to do something. And I just want to get this off my chest because it's bugging me. But we're going to sit here and watch all this unfold. And I know we got another meeting starting at 5, but I'd hope to start some discussion about alternative plans to funding the event center. Because we struck out in Pier, we need to take care of it ourselves. Sioux Falls can do that. We have the ability. We have the can-do attitude that can get it done. Anyway, there's a lot of pieces to this puzzle, and I think if we can start talking about it, maybe the rest of the public will start talking about it. Maybe some of our candidates will start talking about it, and hopefully we'll have a solution here in the future. Instead of watching, you know, I hate to use the word leak, this money keep leaking out of Sioux Falls, but we got to wake up. We got to smell the roses and take advantage of this great city we have and protect it. anyway, I just wanted to get that off my chest. Bon Jovi isn't a big deal for me, but you fill in the name. The place was packed, and then I believe they were in Fargo just Friday night. They're skipping right around us, and they're picking on us from all sides, and we're giving it to them, and I hate giving it to them. That's all.
I can tell you that I agree with a lot of what you just said, Greg. Obviously, as a task force member, we know that we are leaking money out of the community, and opportunity is missed every day that we don't have a new facility. But the funding mechanism that you had referenced, I think, was discussed over the course of the Event Center Task Force meetings. And, of course, that would require state legislation as well. And I feel a lot better about what we just proposed than ever having that getting through the legislature. But with that being said, I think the Event Center Task Force is about to reconvene, and we'll kind of go back from the to the drawing board, so to speak, on the funding piece of it. I think the proposal itself has been fairly well accepted. The funding is what is the real hang-up, and I'm sure that we'll have some more discussions on that in the near future. So, but I appreciate your comments greatly. Councilor Brown.
Greg, Bon Jovi is a big deal for my wife, and she was in Fargo Saturday night, so a large Sioux Falls contingency is there as well.
Councilor Anderson.
Just to add on to that, I found out here just last week, too, that not only are we leaking out with our indoor shows and that, but now we've even lost a couple outdoor shows that we had last year. Crowfest has moved out of Sioux Falls and will be playing in Brandon. Last year that was 8,000 people at the Canary Fields. So I mean, those are the type of shows that we're losing left and right here in Sioux Falls because we're not being very friendly to the promoters. And I think that's something else we have to look at.
Councilor Knutson.
Well, I just couldn't agree more with the comments. I'm getting ready to order my tickets for the Frankie Valli concert on May 19th in Sioux City, and I would much prefer to do my business here in Sioux Falls than drive to Sioux City to eat, sleep overnight, or whatever.
Well, we'll look forward to more spirited conversation regarding that. So if there's any other open discussions, very quickly, Councilor Brown.
One quick thing. I did have an obligation at 5:15, but we probably need six members for the joint meeting, do we not? And that we're missing two already.
We'll go fast.
It sounds like it should be a quick meeting, so hopefully you can stick around. Councilor Bannigan, did you have something? Okay. We will adjourn then.